This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. The Crystal Palace was a cast iron and plate glass structure originally built in Hyde Park, London, to house the Great Exhibition of 1851. More than 14,000 exhibitors from around the world gathered in its 990,000 square foot 92,000. Were founded at the site in 1905 and played at the Cup Final venue in their early years. The park still contains Benjamin Waterhouse Hawkins's Crystal Palace dinosaurs, which date back to 1854. It was proposed in 2013 by a Chinese developer to rebuild the Crystal Palace, but the developer's 16-month exclusivity agreement with Bromley Council to develop its plans was cancelled when it expired in February 2015. Contents 1. Original Hyde Park Building 11. Conception 12. Design 13. Construction 2. The Great Exhibition of 1851. 3. Crystal Palace at Sydenham Hill. 31. Relocation and redesign. 32. Exhibitions and notable events. 33. Crystal Palace Park. 34. Decline. 4. Destruction by fire. 5. Since the fire. 51. Crystal Palace Bowl. 52. Future. 6. See also. 7. References. 71. Sources. 72. Notes. 8. External links. Original Hyde Park Building Conception. The transept facade of the original Crystal Palace. The Crystal Palace in Hyde Park for Grand International Exhibition of 1851. The huge, modular, wood, glass and iron structure was originally erected in Hyde Park in London to house the Great Exhibition of 1851, which showcased the products of many countries throughout the world. The commission in charge of mounting the Great Exhibition was established in January 1850, and it was decided at the outset that the entire project would be funded by public subscription. An executive building committee was quickly formed to oversee the design and construction of the exhibition building, comprising Isambard Kingdom Brunel, Robert Stevenson, renowned architects Charles Barry and Thomas Leverton Donaldson, the Duke of Buccleuch and the Earl of Ellesmere, and chaired by William Cubitt. By 15 March 1850 they were ready to invite submissions, which had to conform to several key specifications. The building had to be temporary, simple, as cheap as possible, and economical to build within the short time remaining before the exhibition opening, which had already been scheduled for 1 May 1851. Within 3 weeks, the committee had received some 245 entries, including 38 international submissions from Australia, the Netherlands, Belgium, Hanover, Switzerland, Brunswick, Hamburg and France. 2 designs, both in iron and glass, were singled out for praise, one by Richard Turner, co-designer of the Palm House at Kew, and the other by French architect Hector Horo. But despite the great number of submissions, the committee rejected them all. Turner was furious at the rejection, and reportedly badgered the commissioners for months afterwards, seeking compensation, but at an estimated £300,000, his design, like Horro's, was too expensive. As a last resort, the committee came up with a standby design of its own, for a brick building in the Rundbogenstil by Donaldson, featuring a sheet iron dome designed by Brunel, but it was widely criticized and ridiculed when it was published in the newspapers, adding to the committee's woes. The site for the exhibition was still not confirmed. The preferred site was in Hyde Park, adjacent to Prince's Gate near Kensington Road. But other sites considered included Wormwood Scrubs, Battersea Park, the Isle of Dogs, Victoria Park and Regent's Park. Opponents of the scheme lobbied strenuously against the use of Hyde Park, and they were strongly supported by the Times. The most outspoken critic was arch-conservative Colonel Charles de Laet Waldo Sibthorpe. He denounced the exhibition as one of the greatest humbugs, frauds and absurdities ever known, and his trenchant opposition to both the exhibition and its building continued even after it had closed. Joseph Paxton's first sketch for the Great Exhibition Building, about 1850, pen and ink on blotting paper, v. Paxton's now famous ridge and furrow roof design, and was at the time the largest glass building in the world, covering around 28,000 square feet 2,600 sqm. A decade later, taking advantage of the availability of the new cast plate glass, Paxton further developed his techniques with the Chatsworth Lily House, which featured a flat roof version of the ridge and furrow glazing, and a curtain wall system that allowed the hanging of vertical bays of glass from cantilevered beams. The Lily House was built specifically to house the giant Victoria Victoria Amazonica water lily, which had only recently been discovered by European botanists. The first specimen to reach England was originally kept at Kew Gardens, but it did not do well. Paxton's reputation as a gardener was so high by that time that he was invited to take the lily to Chatsworth. It thrived under his care, and in 1849 he caused a sensation in the horticultural world when he succeeded in producing the first Amazonica flowers to be grown in England. His daughter Alice was famously drawn for the newspapers, standing on one of leaves. The lily and its house led directly to Paxton's design for the Crystal Palace, and he later cited the huge ribbed floating leaves as a key inspiration. Paxton left his 9 June 1850 meeting with Henry Cole fired with enthusiasm. He immediately went to Hyde Park, where he walked the site earmarked for the exhibition 2 days later. On the 11th of June, while attending a board meeting of the Midland Railway, Paxton made his original concept drawing, which he famously doodled onto a sheet of pink blotting paper. This rough sketch, now in the Victoria Exhibition's opening, which was scheduled for the 1st of May 1851, Paxton was able to design and build the largest glass structure yet created, from scratch, in less than a year, and completed on schedule and on budget. He was even able to alter the design shortly before building began, adding a high, barrel vaulted transept across the center of the building, at 90 degrees to the main gallery, under which he was able to safely enclose several large elm trees that would otherwise have had to be felled, thereby also resolving a controversial issue that had been a major sticking point for the vocal anti-exhibition lobby. Designed partial front left and rear right elevations of the Crystal Palace. Paxton's modular, hierarchical design reflected his practical brilliance as a designer and problem solver. It incorporated many breakthroughs, offered practical advantages that no conventional building could match, and, above all, embodied the spirit of British innovation and industrial might. That the Great Exhibition was intended to celebrate the geometry of the Crystal Palace was a classic example of the concept of form following function. The shape and size of the whole building was directly based around the size of the panes of glass made by the supplier, Chance Brothers of Smethwick. These were the largest available at the time, measuring 10 inches wide by 49 inches long. Because the entire building was scaled around those dimensions, it meant that nearly the whole outer surface could be glazed using millions of identical panes, thereby drastically reducing both their production cost and the time needed to install them. The original Hyde Park building was essentially a vast, flat-roofed rectangular hall. A huge open gallery ran along the main axis, with wings extending down either side. The main exhibition space was 2 stories high, with the upper floor stepped in from the boundary. Most of the building had a flat profile roof, except for the central transept, which was covered by a 72-foot-wide barrel vaulted roof that stood 168 feet high at the top of the arch. Both the flat profile sections and the arched transept roof were constructed using the key element of Paxton's design, his patented ridge and furrow roofing system, which had first use at Chatsworth. The basic roofing unit, in essence, took the form of a long triangular prism, which made it both extremely light and very strong, and meant it could be built with the minimum amount of materials. Paxton set the dimensions of this prism by using the length of single pane of glass 49 inches as the hypotenuse of a right-angled triangle, thereby creating a triangle with a length to height ratio of 25:1, whose base adjacent side was 4 feet long. By mirroring this triangle, he obtained the 8-foot wide gables that formed the vertical faces at either end of the prism, each of which was 24 feet long. With this arrangement, Paxton could glaze the entire roof surface with identical panes that did not need to be trimmed. Paxton placed 3 of these 8 feet by 24 feet roof units side by side, horizontally supported by a grid of cast iron beams, which was held up on slim cast iron pillars. The resulting cube, with a floor area of 24 by 24 feet, formed the basic structural module of the building. By multiplying these modules into a grid, the structure could be extended virtually infinitely in its original form. The ground level of the Crystal Palace in plan measured 1848 × 456, which equates to a grid 77 modules long by 19 modules wide. Because each module was self-supporting, Paxton was able to leave out modules in some areas, creating larger square or rectangular spaces within the building to accommodate larger exhibits on the lower level. These larger spaces were covered by the floor above, and on the upper level by longer spans of roofing, but the dimensions of these larger spaces were always multiples of the basic 24 feet by 24 feet grid unit. The modules were also strong enough to be stacked vertically, enabling Paxton to add an upper floor that nearly doubled the amount of available exhibition space, Paxton also used longer trellis girders to create a clear span for the roof of the immense central gallery, which was 72 feet wide and 1,800 feet long. Plan of the Crystal Palace. Paxton's roofing system incorporated his elegant solution to the problem of draining the building's vast roof area like the Chatsworth Lily House, but unlike its later incarnation at Sydenham, most of the roof of the original Hyde Park structure had a horizontal profile, so heavy rain posed a potentially serious safety hazard because normal cast glass is brittle and has low tensile strength. There was a risk that the weight of any excess water buildup on the roof might have caused panes to shatter, showering shards of glass onto the patrons, ruining the valuable exhibits beneath, and weakening the structure. However, Paxton's ridge and furrow roof was designed to shed water very efficiently. Rain ran off the angled glass roof panes into U-shaped cast iron channels which ran the length of each roof section at the bottom of the furrow. These channels were ingeniously multifunctional. During construction, they served as the rails that supported and guided the trolleys on which the glazers sat as they installed the roofing. Once completed, the channels acted both as the joists that supported the roof sections, and as guttering, a patented design now widely known as a Paxton gutter. These gutters conducted the rainwater to the ends of each furrow, where they emptied into the larger main gutters, which were set at right angles to the smaller gutters. Along the top of the main horizontal roof bearers, these main gutters drained at either end into the cast iron pillars, which also had an ingenious dual function. Each was cast with a hollow core, allowing it to double as a concealed down pipe that carried the storm water down into the drains beneath the building. One of the few issues Paxton could not completely solve was leaks. When completed, rain was found to be leaking into the huge building in over 1,000 places. The leaks were sealed with putty, but the relatively poor quality of the sealant materials available at the time meant that the problem was never totally overcome. Maintaining a comfortable temperature inside such a large glass building was another major challenge, because the Great Exhibition took place decades before the introduction of mains electricity and air conditioning. Glasshouses rely on the fact that they accumulate and retain heat from the sun, but such heat buildup would have been a major problem for the exhibition, and this would have been exacerbated by the heat produced by the thousands of people who would be in the building at any given time. Paxton solved this with two clever strategies. One was to install external canvas shade cloths that were stretched across the roof ridges. These served multiple functions. They reduced heat transmission, moderated and softened the light coming into the building, and acted as a primitive evaporative cooling system when water was sprayed onto them. The other part of the solution was Paxton's ingenious ventilation system. Each of the modules that formed the outer walls of the building was fitted with a prefabricated set of loos that could be opened and closed using a gear mechanism, allowing hot stale air to escape. The flooring consisted of boards 22. Function, the gaps between the boards acted as a grating that allowed dust and small pieces of refuse to fall or be swept through them onto the ground beneath, where it was collected daily by a team of cleaning boys. Paxton also designed machines to sweep the floors at the end of each day, but in practice, it was found that the trailing skirts of the female visitors did the job perfectly thanks to the considerable economies of scale Paxton was able to exploit. The manufacture and assembly of the building parts was exceedingly quick and cheap. Each module was identical, fully prefabricated, self-supporting, and fast and easy to erect. All of the parts could be mass-produced in large numbers, and many parts served multiple functions, further reducing both the number of parts needed and their overall cost because of its comparatively low weight. The Crystal Palace required absolutely no heavy masonry for supporting walls or foundations, and the relatively light concrete footings on which it stood could be left in the ground once the building was removed. They remain in place today just beneath the surface of the site. The modules could be erected as quickly as the parts could reach the site. Indeed, some sections were standing within 18 hours of leaving the factory, and since each unit was self-supporting, workers were able to assemble much of the building section by section, without having to wait for other parts to be finished construction. Interior of the Crystal Palace. Fox Henderson took possession of the site in July 1850 and erected wooden hoardings which were constructed using the timber that later became the floorboards of the finished building. More than 5,000 navvies worked on the building during its construction, with up to 2,000 on site at one time during the peak building phase. More than 1,000 iron columns supported 2,224 trellis girders and 30 miles of guttering, comprising 4,000 tons of iron in all. First, stakes were driven into the ground down to roughly mark out the positions for the cast iron columns. These points were then set precisely by theodolite measurements. Then the concrete foundations were poured, and the base plates for the columns were set into them once the foundations were in place. The erection of the modules proceeded rapidly. Connector brackets were attached to the top of each column before erection, and these were then hoisted into position. Since the project took place before the development of powered cranes, the raising of the columns was done manually using shears or shear legs, a simple crane mechanism. These consisted of two strong poles, which were set several meters apart at the base and then lashed together at the top to form a triangle. This was stabilized and kept vertical by guy ropes fixed to the apex, stretched taut and tied to stakes driven into the ground some distance away using pulleys and ropes hung from the apex of the shear. The navvies hoisted the columns, girders and other parts into place. As soon as two adjacent columns had been erected, a girder was hoisted into place between them and bolted onto the connectors. The columns were erected in opposite pairs, then two more girders were connected to form a self-supporting square. This was the basic frame of each module. The shears would then be moved along and an adjoining bay constructed when a reasonable number of bays had been completed. The columns for the upper floor were erected. Longer shear legs were used for this, but the operation was essentially the same as for the ground floor once the ground floor structure was complete. The final assembly of the upper floor followed rapidly for the glazing. Paxton used larger versions of machines he had originally devised for the great stove at Chatsworth, installing on-site production line systems, powered by steam engines, that dressed and finished the building parts. These included a machine that mechanically grooved the wooden window sash bars, and a painting machine that automatically dipped the parts in paint and then passed them through a series of rotating brushes to remove the excess. A tree enclosed within the Crystal Palace. The last major components to be put into place were the 16 semicircular ribs of the vaulted transept, which were also the only major structural parts that were made of wood. These were raised into position as 8 pairs, and all were fixed into place within a week thanks to the simplicity of Paxton's design and the combined efficiency of the building contractor and their suppliers. The entire structure was assembled with extraordinary speed. The team of 80 glazers could fix more than 18,000 panes of sheet glass in a week, and the building was complete and ready to receive exhibits in just 5 months when completed. The Crystal Palace provided an unrivaled space for exhibits, since it was essentially a self-supporting shell standing on slim iron columns, with no internal structural walls whatsoever because it was covered almost entirely in glass. It also needed no artificial lighting during the day, thereby reducing the exhibition's running costs. Full-size elm trees growing in the park were enclosed within the central exhibition hall near the 27-foot-8. Final dimensions were 1,848 feet 563. 186,000 pounds, equivalent to £18,370,000, money which was used to found the Victoria and Albert Museum, the Science Museum and the Natural History Museum in South Kensington. The Crystal Palace had the first major installation of public toilets, the retiring rooms, in which sanitary engineer George Jennings installed his monkey closet flushing lavatory initially just for men, but later catering for women also. During the exhibition, 827,280 visitors each paid 1 penny to use them, from which originated the euphemism "spending a penny." The Great Exhibition closed on the 11th of October 1851. 1851 medal the Crystal Palace in London by Allen. Sydenham Hill. The Crystal Palace, after its move to Sydenham Hill in 1854, the construction of the building began on Sydenham Hill in 1852. The new building, while incorporating most of the constructional parts of the Hyde Park building, was so completely different in form as to be properly considered a quite different structure, a Beaux Arts form in glass and metal. The main gallery was redesigned and covered with a new barrel vaulted roof. The central transept was greatly enlarged and made even higher, and two new transepts were added at either end of the main gallery. It was modified and enlarged so much that it extended beyond the boundary of Penge Place, which was also the boundary between Surrey and Kent. The reconstruction was recorded for posterity by Philip Henry Delamotte, and his photographs were widely disseminated in his published works. Within just 2 years, the rebuilt palace building was complete, and in 1854, Queen Victoria again performed an opening ceremony. Several localities claim to be the area to which the building was moved. The street address of the Crystal Palace was Sydenham SESE 26 after 1917, but the actual building and parklands were in Penge when built. Most of the buildings were in the county of Surrey, as were the majority of grounds, but in 1899 the county boundary was moved, transferring the entire site to Penge Urban District in Kent. The site is now within the Crystal Palace ward of the London Borough of Bromley and 1857 plan of the grounds of the Crystal Palace. Two railway stations were opened to serve the permanent exhibition, Crystal Palace High Level, developed by the LCDR. It was an impressive building designed by Edward Barry, from which a subway under the parade led directly to the entrance Crystal Palace Low Level, developed by Lawing and Schuster's LB. Alhambra, Roman, Renaissance, Pompeian, and Grecian art and many others during the year of reopening. 18 handbooks were published in the Crystal Palace Library by Bradbury. Of arrangements for the 11th season, commencing on 1 May 1864, included the Shakespeare Tercentenary Festival and a course by designer Christopher Dresser. The Daily program for Monday, October 6, 1873 included a harvest exhibition of fruit, and the Australasian Collection, formed by H. E. Payne, of materials from Tasmania, New Caledonia, Solomon Islands, Australia, NZ, and Grand Military Fete was also on offer. Many of these publications were printed by Dickens and Evans, that is Charles Dickens Jr., Dickens' son, working with his father-in-law Frederick Evans. Another feature of the early programming were Christmas pantomimes, with published librettos, for instance Harry Lemon's Dick Whittington and His Wonderful Cat. Crystal Palace Christmas 1869-70, London 1869 Handel Festival at the Crystal Palace, 1887-1889. In 1868, the world's first aeronautical exhibition was held in the Crystal Palace. In 1871, the world's first cat show, organized by Harrison Weir, was held there. Other shows, such as dog shows, pigeon shows, honey, flower shows, as well as the first National Motor Show, were also held at Crystal Palace. The match, which later has been dubbed the world's first bandy match, was held at the Crystal Palace in 1875. At the time, the game was called Hockey on the Ice. The new site was also the location of one of Charles Spurgeon's famous sermons, Without Amplification, before a crowd of 23,654 people on 7 October 1857. A colorful description of a visit to the Crystal Palace appears in John Davidson's poem. The Crystal Palace, published in 1909, Festival of Empire 1911, with the Canadian building in the foreground. In 1909, Robert Baden-Powell first noticed the interest of girls in scouting while attending a Boy Scout meeting at Crystal Palace. This observation later led to the formation of Girl Guides, then Girl Scouts. In 1911, the Festival of Empire was held at the building to mark the coronation of George V and Queen Mary. Large pavilions were built for and by the colonies, that for Canada, for instance, replicating the Parliament in Ottawa. A good record of the festival is provided by the photogravure plates in the sale catalogue published shortly afterwards by Knight, Frank and Rutley and Horn. The Imperial War Museum and Great Victory Exhibition. Crystal Palace, published by Photochrom. A few years later, the Imperial War Museum moved to South Kensington, and then in the 1930s to its present site, Geraldine Mary Harmsworth Park, formerly Bedlam. On 15-20 October 1934, the Pageant of Labour was held at the Crystal Palace. Crystal Palace Park. Main articles: Crystal Palace Park and Crystal Palace Dinosaurs. An 1853 model of an iguanodon, the most recognizable of the Crystal Palace dinosaurs. The development of ground and gardens of the park cost considerably more than the rebuilt Crystal Palace. Edward Milner designed the Italian garden and fountains, the Great Maze, and the English landscape garden. Raphael Monti was hired to design and build much of the external statuary around the fountain basins, and the urns, tazzes and vases. The sculptor Benjamin Waterhouse Hawkins was commissioned to make 33 life-sized models of the then newly discovered dinosaurs and other extinct animals in the park. The palace and its park became the location of many shows, concerts and exhibitions, as well as sporting events. After the construction of various sports grounds on the site, the FA Cup final was held here between 1895 and 1914. On the new site were also various buildings that housed educational establishments such as the Crystal Palace School of Art, Science, and Literature, as well as engineering schools. The Crystal Palace, with one of the water towers, is seen from Annerley around 1910. Joseph Paxton was first and foremost a gardener, and his layout of gardens, fountains, terraces and cascades left no doubt as to his ability. One thing he did have a problem with was water supply. Such was his enthusiasm that thousands of gallons of water were needed to feed the myriad fountains and cascades abounding in the Crystal Palace Park. The two main jets were 250 feet 76. encouraged to work at the palace on Sunday, and that if people wanted to visit, then their employers should give them time off during the working week. However, the palace was open on Sundays by May 1861, when 40,000 visitors came. By the 1890s, the palace's popularity and state of repair had deteriorated. The appearance of stalls and booths had made it a more downmarket attraction. In the years after the Festival of Empire, the building fell into disrepair, as the huge debt and maintenance costs became unsustainable, and in 1911 bankruptcy was declared. In 1914, the Earl of Plymouth bought it, to save it from developers. A public subscription subsequently bought it from the Earl for the nation. In the 1920s, a board of trustees was set up under the guidance of manager Sir Henry Buckland. He is said to have been a firm but fair man, who had a great love for the Crystal Palace, and soon set about restoring the deteriorating building. The restoration not only brought visitors back, but also meant that the palace started to make a small profit once more. Buckland and his staff also worked on improving the fountains and gardens, including the Thursday evening displays of fireworks by Brock's Destruction by Fire. Crystal Palace on Fire, 1936. On the 30th of November 1936 came the final catastrophe, fire. Within hours the palace was destroyed. The glow was visible across 8 counties that night. Buckland was walking his dog near the palace, with his daughter Crystal Buckland, named after the palace, when they noticed a red glow within. Inside, he found 2 of his employees fighting a small office fire that had started after an explosion in the women's cloakroom. Realizing that it was a serious fire, they called the Penge Fire Brigade, but, even though 89 fire engines and over 400 firemen arrived, they were unable to extinguish it. The fire spread quickly in the high winds that night, because it could consume the dry old timber flooring, and the huge quantity of flammable materials in the building. Buckland said, "In a few hours we have seen the end of the Crystal Palace, yet it will live in the memories not only of Englishmen, but the whole world." 100,000 people came to Sydenham Hill to watch the blaze, among them Winston Churchill, who said, "This is the end of an age." Just as in 1866, when the North Transept burnt down, the building was not adequately insured to cover the cost of rebuilding at least £2 million. The South Tower had been used for tests by television pioneer John Logie Baird for his mechanical television experiments, and much of his work was destroyed in the fire. The last singer to perform there before the fire was the Australian ballad contralto Essie Ackland. Since the fire, Crystal Palace, a few days after the night of the 30th of November 1936, totally destroyed. All that was left standing after the 1936 fire were the 2 water towers. In a November 2011 interview with the Crystal Palace Museum, the true story of the towers was revealed. The south tower to the right of the Crystal Palace entrance was taken down shortly after the fire, as the damage sustained had undermined its integrity and it presented a major risk to houses nearby. The north tower was demolished with explosives in 1941. No reason was given for its removal, although it was rumored that it was to remove a landmark for World War II German aircraft, but Luftwaffe bombers actually navigated their way to central London by tracking the River Thames. The Crystal Palace grounds were also used as a manufacturing base for aircraft radar screens and other high-tech equipment of the time. This remained secret until well after the war. After the destruction of the palace, the high-level branch station fell into disuse, and was finally shut in 1954. Crystal Palace site, remains of the upper terrace, 1993. After the war, the site was used for a number of purposes. Between 1927 and 1972, the Crystal Palace motor racing circuit was located in the park, supported by the Greater London Council, but the noise was unpopular with nearby residents and racing hours were soon regulated under a High Court judgment. Crystal Palace Bowl. Between 1971 and 1980, a series of annual Crystal Palace Garden Parties took place in the summer months. Many famous as well as aspiring pop artists made their appearances at the Crystal Palace Bowl, including Pink Floyd, The Beach Boys, Lou Reed, Melanie, Mahavishnu Orchestra, Santana, Bob Marley, The Chieftains, John Cale, and Golden Earring. Future. Over the years, numerous proposals for the former site of the palace have not come to fruition. Plans by the London Development Agency to spend £675. Infomart, a building in Dallas, Texas modeled after the Crystal Palace. New York. Crystal Palace, an 1853 exhibition building built in New York glass pavilion. List of demolished buildings and structures in London. References. Sources. John McKean, Crystal Palace, Joseph Paxton. Histoire de la construction, ed. Roberto Gargiani, Lausanne, Suisse, 2008. ISBN 978-2-88074-714-5. Notes. Carat, The Crystal Palace of Hyde Park, retrieved 4 April 2008. By a reference in The Leader, number 17, the 20th of July 1850 p. 1, in more than one country we notice active preparations for sending inanimate representatives of trade and industry to take up their abode in the Crystal Palace which M.R. Paxton is to build for the Exposition of 1851. Source: British Periodicals Database or 19th Century Serials Edition, archived 17 April 2009 at the Wayback Machine. AB BBC News, plans for Crystal Palace replica, 27 July 2013, retrieved 27 July 2013. Disguise, The Visionary Life of Joseph Paxton. Harper Collins, 2004, ch. 16. Hitchcock, Henry Russell. 1977. Architecture, 19th and 20th Centuries. Harmonsworth, Penguin Books. P. ABC, Sketch for the Crystal Palace. He's Going to Spend a Penny. Now You Know. Big Book of Answers. 2. Dundurn. P. Crystal Palace Foundation. Five stories made at Sydenham. The £150,000 cost of the Hyde Park Crystal Palace includes the reusable component material cost, so the extent to which the reconstructed palace had an unexpectedly higher construction cost is even greater than the comparison of totals implies. Carrot Memorial from the National Sunday League on the Sunday opening of the British Museum. Working men and their families worked long hours and all day Saturday. Many could not afford a day's unpaid leave to come to the museum. ABC, London, the 21st of December 1936, London's biggest fire. Life, 34. The Crystal Palace will never be rebuilt. Radio Times article. Ellen, Richard G. The 5th of April 2003, Baird's Independent Television Transdiffusion Broadcasting System, retrieved the 29th of May 2008.